thank you very much. Could you just clarify for me whether the polygamy law as it stands, as you presented it, with especially the descriptor of any conjugal union, does that also apply to polyandry and polyamory?
Yes, it's not gender specific.
Okay, thank you.
I'm not a lawyer. I'm a common citizen, as many of the people are in this part of the world, although they are so ignorant. What happens to the children who learn nothing but what they have seen? Is it not a permanent harm to the society, to certain the citizens who have been subject, who have not seen anything else but polygamy? And getting the young ones out so that they can be at both of the society?
It's an excellent question. I think this is part of why I moved away from the religious freedom argument, partly because I don't think religious freedom can be an exception to a validly constituted criminal law. But this raises some difficult and uncomfortable questions in our society about the nature of religious freedom and the unfettered parental authority and the unfettered authority of some communities to indoctrinate in their children any set of beliefs. And in the context of Bountiful, there are legitimate concerns about the nature to which the children are insulated from public education, are isolated from society, and I tend to reject the idea that parents have an unfettered authority to set the religious convictions of their children. I actually think there's a serious freedom of conscience issue occurring there. But that's a larger issue than whether polygamy itself should be criminalized, should continue to be an offense. That is a very important debate that the society needs to have, and it cannot logically only extend to communities in which polygamy is being practiced. It must extend to the very function and nature of the protection of religious belief in the context of the family.
Absolutely no legal training in anything, but I'm wondering, when it comes to the role of religion and economics and politics, if we're not seeing a lot of red herrings thrown up with a political reason behind them rather than worried about women or rights or anything else, if the rule of law can be used as a blunt instrument to achieve other ends other than where for people are.
Well, and this is part of what motivated me around this issue in particular. I'm actually quite troubled by the actions of the Attorney General of BC in relation to polygamy. I mean, the Attorney General was severely cut down by the Supreme Court in a different decision and found to simply be, you know, special prosecutor shopping. And dealing with a situation in which he was receiving advice from his Crown Counsel that they did not feel that an indictment was possible able to actually pursue indictments because they felt the law was unconstitutional. That is, in fact, that's one of the primary functions of the Attorney General. We never hear about it because Attorney Generals are rarely going to actually take a position that a particular law of their government is unconstitutional. But we do. That is a serious rule of law problem that we've encountered in BC, and this is actually another paper I'm working on. I seem to be the only one, but I'm really troubled by the idea of an advisory opinion preceding a sort of a parliamentary committee hearing involving a single judge in a lower court. I think it's unprecedented, actually, in countries with an advisory function power to have a reference proceeding in such a lower level of court. And I think it raises enormous concerns for me as to how that's actually moving our reference function in ways that I think are really undesirable. So yes, I think that there's a lot of politics involved in this, not necessarily always, and I would say not even primarily directed towards the harms experienced by women and children.
I was just wondering if then the polygamy law is struck down because of its arbitrariness, what are the remaining protections in the criminal code for women and children, and if you think they're adequate?
So existing offenses, sexual contact with a minor, sexual assault, as I said, which of course functions to protect both minors and adults. Sexual exploitation, that is somewhat more limited. Trafficking in persons, there's also a really fabulous, I use that term perversely, there's actually an offense of corrupting children by, for example, exposing them to immorality such as adultery, and it has actually resulted in successful convictions in the last 20 years. Now that's not necessarily one that I would endorse, but there are a number of offenses currently on the books. If, though, you look at the elements that the Attorney General has suggested could be read in, such as gross imbalance of power and undue influence, I mean, those are elements mostly which come to us from the civil law, have very little basis in our criminal law tradition, and I think there's an open debate to be had as to whether the degree to which we are prepared to investigate into relationships involving adults and actually use the criminal law to sanction some aspects of those relationships in those respects. But clearly, if that's going to be a concern, it has to be a concern in any relationship, not just plural marriages.
And nobody may ask another question. Again, I have no legal expertise or much knowledge about anything. This is a two-part question. One is, religions brought us to where we are today, and because of religions, there are lots of things that happen which I don't want to say good or bad. Everybody knows what they happen. In the charter, there is provision for freedom of religion, but the freedom of religion cannot override the other parts of the charter, can they?
So that's right. No charter right can, technically, no charter right like freedom of religion can trump another right in the charter, and all charter rights are subject to reasonable limitation. If the state can demonstrate that there is that there is justification for limiting the right that is consistent with a free and democratic society, so no right in the charter is absolute.
So anybody can create a new religion, and it could be such that it can override all these things which have been talked about. They can live in a polygamous society, polyamorous society, raise children, eat children, do anything which can be possible.
Well, the definition of religion has actually been largely divorced from any institutional religious dogma or doctrine. The courts have said freedom of religion exists as an individual's sincerely held conviction that a certain belief or practice is required to foster, I think the term is, a relationship with the divine. Don't forget, we also have freedom of conscience in the very same section of the charter, even though it has been virtually rendered a nullity, which I think is very unfortunate. We do also have freedom of conscience, which does not require you to point to any particular religious beliefs.
So a cannibalistic sect would be acceptable in the charter?
No.
A person could try and argue that any particular criminal law, any law, violates the freedom of religion. Okay? The threshold to make that argument, the violation, is pretty low. But there is ample room for the state to argue that the limitation is justified. So it is not a no-holds-barred exercise. There is an extensive tradition, and we actually have a case from Alberta just a couple of years ago where a significant limitation on the Hatterian Brethren's religious practice was upheld. So it's not open season in terms of freedom of religion on all other charter rights and all other social interests.
Last and final question, maybe you can think about it.
We've got other questioners
too. The question is, when there are so important questions to be decided which affect the whole society, the coming generations, should there not be a whole bar association should be the one which should come with the majority, rather three judges and two judges deciding that. Just by a majority of one, rather than it should be a majority of the whole society which is represented by the bar association.
I guess that's a larger question about judicial review, which I think we made that decision, I guess going on now 27 years ago. And we have the rule of law, and our constitution is supreme, and it is an essential function of the judiciary to apply the law consistent with the constitution and rule, and where appropriate to rule laws null and void where they actually violate the constitution. And that's a fundamental principle of our society that was reached by political agreement involving much more than the Bar Association. I don't know of anyone who would endorse that particular.
But Carissima, it's also possible for if people were sufficiently outraged, you know, by a particular court result, the legislators can convene of that particular jurisdiction and pass a law, assuming it is itself constitutional, to obtain a different result. And that's sort of
yes.
I think the question is really about, well, partly about the relationship between the courts and the broader society.
The court is only 3-2 decision, whereas or broader, the bar association, the very large segment of society to decide.
But I mean, part of the advisory function is actually to draw on the particular expertise of the courts, in effect, to try and predetermine these issues, so that you remove the need for litigation. And arguments pro and con. But that's right, there's always the opportunity for a legislative response consistent with the Constitution.
Jennifer.
Really interesting talk, Carissima. And my question's about overbreadth. So another argument you often hear made against the polygamy provision is that not all polygamous relationships are necessarily harmful.
Right.
How does that fit into your analysis, do you think?
It's
another way of thinking about arbitrariness, maybe.
It's an essential undercurrent because, from its inception, the kind of harm that Mormon polygamy was seen as is not one that we would recognize today as being appropriate or suitable for the targeting by the criminal law. But the use of polygamy as a proxy for harm, I think, is not borne out by the evidence because of the way that the law is crafted. Because there is, in fact, no requirement to show harm. And if you just look at the jurisprudence which talks about substituted elements, it has to be such that there's no reasonable possibility that you could, in fact, convict someone who doesn't meet the required elements, or in this case, the objective of the offense. And that's clearly not the case with respect to polygamy because it is so broad. And we see testimony from people. I think it's very hard to simply tell someone, well, you're actually operating under false consciousness and you don't realize that you're really oppressed. I mean, I'm not talking about necessarily the women who come from very restricted religious traditions, but other people who practice forms of polygamy.